YGTV had the pleasure of meeting His Worship, the Mayor of Gibraltar, Julio Alcantara, for an interview. Your Worship, thank you very much for taking the time to meet with us today. First question, you have been in office since July 2011. What would you say is a typical day for the Mayor of Gibraltar?
It varies so much. There's no typical day. You almost wake up and say, well, let's see what the day brings. I've moved around from the world of judo to model soldiers to the Royal Gibraltar Regiment and lads from Afghanistan. There's a whole, this is the beauty of the role. I'm increasingly surprised by the variety and depth of what goes on in Gibraltar. It's a lovely town, thriving.
We agree as well. What would you say the qualities for the Mayor of Gibraltar must be for them to really discharge their duties of office?
Difficult to reply. Perhaps other people have to. Essentially is wanting, wanting to represent your town. I am, to some extent, the public face of Gibraltar when I meet people from outside, Mayor of Ballymena, things like that. You represent your town, and you need to be aware of it and be proud of the fact that that is what you're doing. Outgoing personality, used to public service, because the demands can be quite crucial. Demands on time, preparation of what to say. You need to be very, very careful. Like now, I need to be careful. I don't put my foot in it.
I'm sure you won't. According to your biography, we know that you are retired, but you keep yourself very busy. You are a trustee for the charity Akin, a Hatha yoga teacher, a member of the Police Complaints Board, chair of the Housing Allocation Committee, and chairman of the Scouts, as well as the Mayor of Gibraltar. And for being somebody that's supposed to be retired, it seems like you keep yourself very, very busy. How do you manage to cope with all that?
It's been part of my life. My generation, the oldies, we grew up in a world that had nothing. Post-war, if you wanted to party, you had to create your own music, you had to bring your own drinks, create your own space. We're used to having to do things, and this is part of what my generation does. We belong endlessly to different committees trying to help. For me, it's just what life has been. It's no different. Keeps me busy.
Keeps you young as well.
I hope so.
Okay, the role as mayor includes many civic duties. Is there any one thing in particular that you've accomplished that you're very proud of?
The one thing that I set myself out to do, and given the short space of time that 1 year represents, not enough of it, is to say thank you to a whole variety of incredible individuals working behind the scenes, not seeking recognition or public acclaim, cancer volunteers, fundraising for Save the Children, for Oxfam, people in the Red Cross Committee, you name it. There's a whole string of people giving their time for sports, for leisure, for young people in soccer, in hockey, in the martial arts. They are incredible, committed people. And one of the pluses for me is actually being able to meet them and say, on behalf of this committee, thank you very, very much. We know what you're doing. We've actually noticed what you're doing. Please, can we say thank you? Holding a reception here, like we held for all the cancer organizations, that is very satisfying.
Fantastic. Okay, and during your time as a teacher, Was there any particular student that stood out over the years that you can still remember, be it good or bad?
No, the bad ones I won't mention. No, 72 sticks out. It's the time when the 11 plus, which probably doesn't mean much to you, but it was a deadly time for the people, not the ones that went to the grammar school, but the people that failed it. At the ripe age of 11, people told them, you're a failure, you're no good. So very proud of what the teaching profession did in getting rid of that exam and creating the comprehensive set, the Bayside and Westside today. 72 was the beginning. And I remember that particular intake with great, great love. We were very lucky that we got exceptional people. Which are still around today. There's Henry Sacramento that everybody knows on one side. There's Peter Montegrifo, the lawyer and politician. Stephen Linares, who now Minister for Culture. There's a whole range of people. One's a successful surgeon in Scotland, another one is actually head of technology in Tokyo, Japan, teaching the Japs about technology. Very, very, I'm very proud of that particular intake and what education has achieved through them.
Okay. In your younger years, you were very active. You played soccer, hockey, rowed, and you were even involved in fencing. Why fencing?
Almost by accident. Because a minor unit in the army found itself with extra foil fencing equipment, which a teacher called Joe Busaglo picked up. He established a fencing sport in Gibraltar. I moved to college very soon after that, and I was able to practice that at my college in Britain. I used to tutor in a girls' college, which was a glorious plus, but don't tell my wife.
Okay, we'll try not to. You were the first Gibraltarian Director of Education as well, Your Worship. Obviously the times have changed, things have moved on. What do you think are the biggest differences between education when you were there and education today?
The biggest innovation, if I can call it that, was the doing away with the point system for scholarships, where it became wide open to anybody that aspired to go to Britain to train, to study in an that was an almighty revolution. Some people still aren't happy that it's that free for people to choose whatever they want. I think that's the only way we're going to survive. We have nothing in Gibraltar by way of land. We have nothing by way of agriculture. We haven't got oil or diamonds, but we have people. And people is what the scholarship system enhances, improves. So if we have a surfeit of lawyers, okay, and engineers, okay. But in the meantime, the quality of the life in Gibraltar, a place of this size, with this size of population, I've never met anything remotely like it anywhere else in the world. And I challenge anybody to say, look, I know a place just like Jim. 30,000 people, and we produce all sorts of highly skilled individuals. Go out to the world, and they make their mark.
As an avid member as well of the Young Christian Workers, what experience would you say has been the most memorable?
Was actually meeting the founder, Belgian priest. He created... He was actually imprisoned by the Nazis, came close to being killed off during the war, but he sacrificed his life for young workers, and he created a whole new approach that re-educated the church in how they dealt with working class people, bringing religious values, spiritual values to people that were working in mines, in factories, close to almost being slave labor. And he brought them out of that, gave them a motivation for life, for service. He was made a cardinal by the Vatican, and I met him. I met him in Thailand. We sat on the floor and shared a cup of coffee. That is what he was like. A great, great man, and he one of the greatest influence in my life.
This is where we change the interview style a little bit. If somebody were to write your biography and you were able to choose the title for it, what would you choose as a title?
What might have been?
What might have been? Why would you say that?
Over a period of time, I've been approached over the years, not recently, to enter politics, things like that. And I've always wondered what might have been. But I have grudging respect for politicians, especially in a place like Gibraltar, because we demand a lot from them, and sometimes can be lacking in gratitude. I've known friends that they've gone now. People like Abraham Surfati, Sir Joshua Hassan. Once they're out of politics, we've almost forgotten all that they have done. So I wonder what might have been, but I'm glad I chose not to.
Okay. Again, another one completely off the usual tracks for interviews, but if you woke up one morning and found that you could time travel, what would you do?
I'd love to be a Roman general. Not a legionary, not a centurion, you know, top guy. Provided my name was not Julius Caesar, but we all know how he finished up. Roman times intrigued me. As well as Nelson's navy, I have time for. I wouldn't mind being master and commander, provided I wasn't Captain Bly.
Those are both periods of war.
Well, essentially, the history that we pick up is the history of war. It's only now that we're beginning to write, even in Gibraltar, the history of people. Most of what we know about, or what I knew about my own town's history, when invariably the great siege, that cannon, that battery, it's only now that we're beginning to get together, piece together, what it was like to be a Gibraltarian in Gibraltar at whatever time.
Your Worship, thank you very much for taking
my
the time to meet us.
My pleasure.